So thanks everyone for joining us. Today we have Yakov Babichenko, who is going to tell us about the complexity of Nash equilibrium.
And thank you. Thanks for the invitation. Thanks for having me. This is a joint work with Aviad Rubinstein from Stanford. I know how hard it is to stay focused on Zoom talks, at least for me. So let me start from the bottom line. Okay, I will present the main result then I will discuss it in details. So our main result is that computing mixed Nash equilibrium in congestion games is PPAD intersection PLS complete. Okay, in a moment I will explain what exactly PPAD intersection PLS is. The highlights of this result is first, it's the first computational hardness evidence for mixed Nash equilibrium in any subclasses of potential games.
Question, complete refers to the intersection or only to PLS?
Refers to the intersection.
Okay.
It's, there is a class called PPAD.
Yeah, no, I know what complete means. I just, you can interpret that, you can parse this two different ways.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure.
Yeah. So it's to the complete to the entire intersection, in the for the entire intersection. Second, it's the first natural problem that is proved to be hard, and in this case, even complete, in PPAD intersection PLS or any its subclasses, okay? And here, when I say natural, so the kind of standard interpretation of the word of the terminology and natural problem in complexity is a problem with explicit input that does not contain circuits, okay? So what corollaries do we have from this result? So one corollary is in terms of classes, that the class PPAD intersection PLS equals to the class CCLS. I will not assume that you know what CCLS is. I will explain it in a few slides. Another corollary from this result, which has nothing to do with the game theory, rather it considers a standard, quite standard optimization problem, is that local optimization of degree 5 polynomials is computationally equivalent to local optimization of any arbitrary smooth function. Okay, so.
And I guess degree 5 because of Galois, yes.
Obviously, yeah. It's no, so the,
yeah, okay.
The number 5 comes from it essentially has something that has to do with our reduction. Yeah, so you will. I'm not sure you will see exactly why 5 is the correct number in this presentation, but the main issue is that it's constant degree polynomials. So essentially, let me start with the kind of introducing the result in the context of existing literature. So in the early 90s, Papadimitriou and Megiddo have defined the class TFNP of total search problems. Those are search problems where the solution is guaranteed to exist and it can be verified efficiently. Namely, there is an efficient algorithm that can verify a solution and you always have a solution. So it was very successful and very fruitful agenda in the last 3 decades to classify problems in this class of TFNP. So in the classical paper by Papadimitriou from 94, he defined the classes PPAD, PLS, PPA, PPP, he defined quite a few classes. For this talk, I think it will be useful to understand what, just in few words, what is PPAD and what is PLS. So essentially PPAD is a class that captures total problems that has a solution via Brouwer's fixed point theorem, or if you want, Sperner's lemma. And the complete problem for PPAD is the problem of computing Nash equilibrium in games. And this is true for many classes of games and many, in particular for congestion games, but not only, also for even for two player games. But for this talk, I think more importantly is that it's complete for congestion games. Sorry, it's not the computing Nash equilibrium in arbitrary in games. So Nash equilibrium is in many classes of games is it's a complete problem in PPAD. For the class PLS, it captures local optimization, but in a discrete local optimization, where essentially you are looking for a vertex that is that has higher value. Let's say you have values for vertices. You are looking for a vertex that is higher, that has higher value than all its neighbors. And in nature, the definition of this problem is this is discrete. And a problem that is complete for PLS for this talk is that of pure mesh computing pure Nash equilibrium in congestion games. Congestion games is a subclass of potential games, and therefore a pure Nash equilibrium is guaranteed to exist, and therefore pure Nash equilibrium in congestion games is in fact a total search problem.
When you say computing, you mean finding one or finding all?
Finding one.
Okay.
And yeah, so by the way, the classes the class PPAD and the class PLS are very, very central in the complexity theory. And there are tens, if not hundreds of problems which are known today to be complete for these classes. But I mentioned just the two most relevant for this talk. What I want to talk now is what happens here. Somewhere
okay, sorry, for the non-expert, I'm sorry. I know everybody else except me should know that. Those are all subclasses of NP?
Yes, NP appears here. Thanks.
Okay, in fact, so PFNP is a subclass of NP, and those are subclasses of that.
Yeah. So here we, and I'm interested in the in what's going on here. Those are problems that has essentially two existence proof, one via Brouwer fixed point theorem and another via some discrete optimization argument. And here we have the class PPAD intersection PLS, which are all the problems that can be solved by PPAD argument, but also by Brouwer fixed point argument, but all and also by some local optimization argument. And in a seminal paper on this subject by Daskalakis and Papadimitrou from 2011, they defined, they showed that this is quite an interesting complexity class. It contains several very interesting questions from different areas. In particular, you can see here the contraction mapping, KKT, which is a variant of optimization, polymatrix identical Nash equilibrium and polymatrix identical interest games. This about many of those I will speak in a moment, so I will not so I will mention it briefly, but also those simple stochastic games, computing an optimal strategies in zero sum simple stochastic games, linear complementarity problem for P matrices. All those problems essentially they lie in the intersection of PPAD and PLS, and it was quite an active area of research also to define new classes there and classify them. And in particular, there is the class CLS, continuous local search, and CCLS, which stands for component-wise convex local search. and there are also others. So,
just to make sure I follow, pure Nash equilibrium in congestion games is PLS, but not PPAD, right? Because you don't need fixed point for that.
Yes.
Am I right? So, yes. What you are doing now is going to mix, and that's where you claim it's you get the intersection, right?
Exactly. Yes.
For pure, it's so PLS somehow sounds like a simpler. I mean, I don't know if I compare, you know, finding a pure Nash in congestion game, that's a much easier problem than a fixed point. It's just local optimization somehow. Finding a maximum of the function, local maximum even, is enough. So sounds like a much easier than PPAD, but still there is no inclusion between PPAD and PLS, you claim.
Yeah, so...
Otherwise you'd have mentioned it.
Yeah, so in fact, there is a separation oracle between these classes in both directions, which means that essentially there is a separation oracle, which means that it's most very likely that those classes are incomparable. Namely, I agree that mathematically, Brouwer fixed point theorem is much deeper observation than the observation that in a discrete graph, there is some vertex that is weakly above the others. But computationally, to find one, it's not necessarily goes one-to-one with the mathematical simplicity or complexity of those notions. And in fact, computing pure Nash equilibrium by some Brouwer argument is probably something impossible because of those separation oracles. The separation oracle essentially is assuming that this problem can be solved efficiently, they show that some problem becomes polynomial while others remain to be hard. Okay, this is roughly speaking what means separation oracle, and there is a separation oracle between PPAD and PLS. So they are in some sense incomparable. Okay, so let me go briefly about, let's talk very briefly about these classes. PPAD intersection PLS is seemingly not very convenient class to work with. For instance, give me any two problems, one that belongs, I want to highlight two completely unrelated problems. One is in PPAD, the other is in PLS. One can be solved by Brouwer, the other can be solved by discrete optimization. Then the problem that is defined by either give me a solution for P1 or please solve me P2 is in their intersection, right? We can, if we want, solve P1 by PPAD, and we can, if we want, to solve P2 by a PLS argument. Okay, so this seemingly this is not very nice class to work with, but this is essentially the class, and the maybe the most famous subclass in the intersection is the class of CLS, which is defined as follows. You have one Brouwer function, let's say from the unit cube to the unit cube and dimensional cube, and you have another potential function from the unit cube to the reals, to the 0, 1. And the question is to find a point X on the in the cube such that the potential of the point is higher than the potential on the Brouwer image of this.
Now, F is continuous, I guess, right?
Yes, yes. You have to assume continuity and, in fact, Lifshitzness, etc., in order that this problem would be defined nicely. Yes, even Lifshitzness is needed. By the way, why this problem belongs to the intersection of PPAD and PLS is quite simple to see, right? Because you can have two strategies to solve this problem. One of them is
find an X,
to find X such that
X equals FX, yeah.
Yeah, and then another one is, okay, let's forget about F, let's ignore F, and let's just find point X that is, let's say that is... maximum, let's say global maximum, then the global maximum is definitely fine, right? But in fact, we need f essentially defines some connection between the points, and we have to find the point x that is only greater than its unique neighbor, right? Every point has to. So this is the class CLS. Another, let's say maybe slightly less famous subclass is that of continuous component-wise concave local local sort, which is find the local optimum of component-wise concave potential functions. I will define it more formally in few slides because it will be somewhat relevant for our results. Let me now go briefly about the problems that will be relevant for this talk. So there are quite a few of them, but for this talk, we have the problem, which I called it PM identical, which stands for polymatrix identical interest gain. And the problem is to find the mixed Nash equilibrium in identical interest polymatrix games. What are polymatrix games? Will come, I will explain in few slides. The problem of finding mixed Nash equilibrium in congestion games, and in fact, congestion is in explicit congestion games.
Wait, Yakov, what do you mean by identical interest?
When identical interest means that all the players in the game has the same utility.
So, okay.
Okay, so it's a subclass of potential games, but in fact, the potential, it's not very far from being a potential game. The only difference between identical interest game and the potential game is essentially some of what is called strategic equivalence shifts, where a player can just by adding to a player some utility by some action that is taken by others, essentially this defines you the entire class of potential games. This is the classical paper of Monderer and Shapley on this topic.
But so in potential games, in potential game, it's not necessarily the case that all agents have the same utility function.
Right, but it's strategically equivalent to an identical interest game.
Yeah. Okay, the due to the potential function.
Yeah, the difference is the payoff that depends on what everybody else, but not you, doing.
Exactly.
That's the definition. I guess recognizing that is not a trivial thing.
Yes, definitely. No. It's not a, okay, so when I'm talking about congestion games, and our main result in this talk will be about congestion games, I mean games that has polynomial number of facilities and polynomial number of actions. Okay, no lying in this context. It's not that everything is polynomial. So the game can be given explicitly. Okay, those are the facilities. Those are the actions of the players, and so on. Okay,
So you are implying somehow that finding mixed equilibrium may be easier than finding pure. You may find it faster if you are allowing also mixed, right?
Exactly. And this was the open problem for quite a few long time. What if we allow for mixed, for finding mixed Nash equilibrium in congestion games? And right, because if we restrict attention only to pure, we know that the problem is PLS complete. Okay, so network congestion games is the problem of finding mixed Nash equilibrium in network congestion games, where the network is given explicitly. Every player has source destinations, et cetera, et cetera. This is a specific class of congestion games, but it's not, according to how I defined it, it's incomparable with congestion games, because from one hand, it has a network structure, but on the other hand, so the facilities cannot be any, the actions cannot be arbitrary, but in fact has to be routes from sources to destination. But from the other hand, it's also not, the number of actions can be exponential, because player may have exponential number of routes from his source to destination. And finally, the problem KKT, the name is from the original, from the paper of Taskalakis and Papadimitriou, is local optimization of explicitly given polynomials. Okay, so you may define the problem of local optimization on where the input is given by a circuit, and this is essentially what, for instance, CCLS does, or you can focus on a subclass of potential functions that has explicit representation, and one simple and nice class of those are polynomials, where you can give the input as the coefficients of the monomials. Okay, if you have polynomial number of monomials, you can give them explicitly. And
what's KKT? It's not cube Docker, right? It's not
considered. In principle, it stands for KKT, and the reason for that, by the way, I'm not sure I'm the best advocate for this, because I also not sure that this is the best name for it, but essentially, when you will see how it is defined on the boundary conditions, then on the boundary conditions, essentially, it starts to remind the KKT, the Kuhn-Tucker.
It is Kuhn-Tucker. It is Carlos Kuhn-Tucker. Yes,
that's correct.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Okay. So I remind you, this is how the picture have looked before, let's say, a year ago or half a year ago, even let's say a couple of months ago. And then there was a very exciting, I think, a very nice result that has been used in parallel to ours by Fearnley, Goldberg, Hollender, and Savani. And essentially what they proved is quite surprising, is that the problem CLS, which has very specific, and I think very clean and nice definition, is in fact complete for PPAD intersection PLS. When I remind you that PPAD intersection PLS seems to be not very convenient class to work with, because there is for instance, the analog of either solve me the one PPAD problem or solve me completely unrelated PLS problem belongs to this class. Another kind of the main result in this paper is the result that finding a fixed point of gradient dynamic is yet another analog of optimization, and that finding a gradient, a fixed point of a gradient dynamic of the gradient descent, for instance, is complete for this class. Their result works for as you can see in blue. You see the natural problems in the context of the natural problems where the input is not given is not given by circuit, but their variant of gradient, the descent fixed point, requires for arbitrary circuits. Okay, so the question of existence of a natural problem in this class remains open, and here is our contribution. So our contribution proves that also the problem KKT of an explicit local optimization of an explicit function and the problem of congestion, finding mixed Nash equilibrium congestion gain, they all are PPAD intersection PLS complete. And in fact, also this class CCLS, which appears here, is also equal to these classes. Okay, and these two papers, ours and theirs, were deduced in parallel. Okay, so now let me go briefly with the main to define slightly more more formally the main ingredients for our purposes. So one of them is that of identical interest polymatrix games. Okay, so identical interest. I just said before what it means, But what are polymatrix games? So you have n players, and the game is given by n choose two, two player identical interest utilities. Okay, a player essentially plays n minus one, each player plays n minus one identical interest games with, this is defined, let's say, on the complete network, and every player plays n minus one games with all his neighbors, which in this case are all the remaining players.
Uij equals uji here, right?
Sorry?
You mean uij equals uji, or uij is equivalent to uji strategically? What
no,
do you mean?
Let's focus on the simple case where it's exactly equal. Okay.
So uij and uji are the same. Okay.
Yeah. By the way, right, so since we are in the computational aspect, those two problems are equivalent because the strategic equivalence shift to make it identical interest and to work with the, this is a simple computational task, right?
So, because it's two players.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Total identical, the total identical interest utility is the sum of all the actions. Okay, so the crucial point is that you cannot play each of the two player games separately, but you have to fix an action that will play simultaneously against all the other players. Now let me define you identical interest polytensor games. Okay, the previous was polymatrix, now we define polytensor games. It's very similar, you have n players, but instead of playing
well,
two
sorry to interrupt, just to understand, uij, everybody gets uij including player k who is neither I nor j? Or
yeah,
you get zero when you are not there?
Yeah, up to strategic equivalence, it's essentially the same, right? But let's think of it as if I'm getting also the utility of, you can think of it in both ways, right? Strategic in terms of mixed Nash equilibria or Nash equilibria, it will not play any role. You can define it as if you get also the utilities that are by okay. edges that you participate.
Yeah. Okay. Correct. Got it.
So, now we are talking, so now I want to define the notion of identical interest polytensor games. Okay, so it's very similar to polymatrix, but instead of matrix, you have tensor. Okay, so instead of two player games, now we're looking at five player identical interest utilities. Okay, for all subsets of all five players. Okay, and the total identical interest utility is given just by the sum of all the, instead, if you want, you can think of it also, instead of having a complete graph, you now have a complete hypergraph where each hyper edge is essentially includes five players. Okay, so this is, so those are, and the number five essentially will just play a role in our, what I want to observe is that polytensor games are congestion are a particular case of congestion games. Why is it so? Because you can define the facilities to be the all the tuples of size of five tuples of actions. Okay, those are the facilities, and an action of player I with mi action is essentially to choose all the action profiles where his action is relevant, where it is is captured here, that the player I belongs to S, and he plays the action J. Okay, so the subsets of facilities that are feasible for player I is essentially to choose all the action profiles where he plays a game and where he plays this specific action. Okay, and then now you can define the latency function on each of these facilities to be UIS of AS if all five players uses facility AS, and in all other cases you define it to be zero. And what will happen in this game is essentially that every player exactly those actions that that are chosen, only those player, those actions that have been chosen by all the five players are the real utilities that you get in the okay. So this is just an observation that polytensor games are in fact congestion games. Therefore, if I prove you some hardness result about polytensor games, it immediately implies the same result about congestion. Okay, another issue which I want to define is that of the problem that I just mentioned before, that of GD fixed point or gradient descent fixed point. So the input is a smooth function, let's say J dimensional function from the cube to 0, 1 and some epsilon. And what you are looking for is to, you want to find the point X, roughly speaking, that whose gradient, there is no improvement in the gradient direction. Okay, so what you can look at the equations, but I think it will be easier to see it from the picture. So for instance, if you are in an interior point, you are not allowed that to have a positive gradient. Namely, you're not allowed that the gradient will be more than epsilon. If you are on a boundary point and the gradient is in this direction, this is allowed, right? Indeed, the gradient descent dynamic will just go in this direction, but then project it back to the cube and you will stay at the same point. There is no better point somewhere around. So this, yeah, right. But if you are on the boundary and you want to go in this direction, this is again illegal, right? Because you can improve by going in this direction. Finally, if you are, let's say, in this vertex and you go in this direction, this is again allowed because the projection, there is no better point. Okay, so this is the GD fixed point problem. It is defined quite simply just by some restriction on the gradients of the function. So first, the gradient descent dynamic converges to some variance. So this is well studied dynamic. Yeah, right. Maybe one of the most central dynamics in optimization, if not the most important one. It is known that it converges to a GD fixed point, but in polynomial in 1/ε time, okay? The query hardness for this problem, if we take a look at the black box model and the problem is not given explicitly, and you are only allowed to ask queries about the function, then it is known, it's an old result by Vavasis, that polynomial number of queries are needed in order to find such a point. Interestingly and somewhat surprisingly, the computational hardness of this seemingly very fundamental problem has been discovered only a few months ago by Fearnley, Goldberg, Hollender and Savani. They proved that this problem is PPAD intersection PLS complete. Okay, and our contribution in this context is to show that it's computationally hard even for explicitly given functions. They proved it for functions that are given by a circuit. And we prove it for explicit functions, in fact, for 5-degree polynomials, okay?
What's a function given by circuit? How is it different than an explicit function? Roughly, don't go into detail, just I want to... Okay, so, I'm probably the only one who doesn't know what circuit is, so...
So a circuit is essentially an arithmetic circuit. It has inputs, which are, it has inputs, it has gates of addition and multiplication and division and maximum and minimum, right? You can look at this type of, at the end, you think of it as a undirected acyclic graph, and at the end of it, it has outputs. Okay, so this is essentially.
So it's a function. Yeah. What makes it worse than a function? That's what I'm trying to understand.
I do not say that it's not. It is a function. But you have specific classes of functions, such as polynomials, where you do not need the input to the problem to be defined by by circuit, but rather you can look at the explicit definition where it's given, for instance, by coefficients of monomials. Okay, if you, in principle, you can also say that. In some sense, you ignore the way the input is given, and then there is another class of you can analyze it by query hardness model.
Wait, is there a difference in the number of gates given a function? How many gates I need versus what size polynomial? What degree polynomial is there? Is there a difference in those two measures? Then it will make sense. Because I still don't understand what's this distinction. I'm sorry, but maybe I'm the only one, as I said, so.
The distinction between a natural problem in the, and not natural, it's kind of quite common in the literature. It is about questions where the definition, which requires in the input, the input has circuits, and those that do not have, which are explicit problems, where, for instance, as congestion games, but also optimization of the degree 5 polynomials.
So if I take a polynomial of degree 5, the number of gates needed to represent it is what, relative to 5?
I think it's in any case this is not the issue, no, because essentially in also in circuits you assume essentially that the number of circuits in any case is polynomial in right, you compare yourself to the size of the circuit, so this is not the issue. You need slightly less linear or maybe n log n gates to represent the polynomial rather than a general function, but this is not the main issue. The main issue is that the explicit functions are those that has explicit representation, for instance, as the polynomials where you have okay.
So would it be good to say that the distinction is syntactic rather than semantic? So it's like Sergio is asking about the semantic distinction and you are saying that there's a syntactic distinction?
Yeah.
But it's content versus representation, right? That's what we are discussing.
The answer is simple. In circuits, you can express more because you don't need to put the same expression many times. Every explicit function formula you can make a circuit. Sometimes you need to expand the, if you have a circuit you want to expand to a formula, you need possibly exponential blow up.
Ah, okay. So going from one to the other is not a polynomial transformation, but it's an exponential transformation. That's the answer.
In principle, in general. Yeah. I'm not sure of it here, but in general. Sure, yeah.
I see, okay. I see, so that example, whatever, so if they have an example with circuits, it may be that shows that this is hard, maybe that example of circuits when it translates to a formula, it becomes exponential, which is bad, because we still want to limit ourselves to polynomial. That's the issue, right? Have I said it correctly?
In principle, yes. I'm not sure about here, but in principle, what you say is correct.
Yeah, no, we are talking principle. I'm just trying to understand the difference. Yes. Okay. Okay. I thanks. I think I got. I'm happy now. Momentarily, I'll be unhappy about something else later, but for now, I'm happy.
Yeah. So what I want to focus on is the GD fixed point problem, and but we can think of it with varying generality of input. Maybe the most general one allows for any smooth potential given by circuit. You can impose a restriction as Daskalakis and Papadimitriou did in their paper, and restrict attention to functions that are component-wise convex. What do I mean by component-wise convex? Fix x minus j, then for every fixed x minus j, this function, which is a function only of one variable xj, is convex in xj. Okay, so you can restrict attention to inputs that satisfy this property. And you can restrict, and this is exactly the problem that defines a GD fixed point on these inputs, essentially is equivalent to the problems to the class CCLS, which was defined in the paper. You can restrict attention to polynomials and where the input is given by monomials. And here I write it in blue because this is a natural problem where the input is given not by circuit, but explicitly. And finally, you can look at essentially at the intersection of these two to look at component-wise concave polynomials where each monomial is component-wise concave. And our main theorem is essentially that all four above variants of GD fixed points, all these four variants, and five polytensor identical interest game and also congestion games are computationally equivalent. Okay, this is our main theorem. And what I want to say about this main theorem, that essentially it looks as if we have here a lot of reductions, but in fact it all relies on one single reduction. We reduce the problem of GD fixed point, the problem of computing a fixed point of arbitrary smooth function in the general instance, to five polytensor identical interest game. Why other parts of the theorem are almost trivial? So mixed Nash equilibrium in five polytensor identical interest game are essentially equivalent to local optima of common utility or of the common utility over the mixed strategy profile domains. But on this domain, this common utility is essentially a degree 5 multilinear polynomial, which in particular is finite degree polynomial. Why I'm saying that it's almost trivial and not exactly trivial? Because there is a mild issue that the domain that we restricted attention to for the GD fixed point is a cube, while here, it's a 5-degree polynomial over a different domain, over a product of simplexes, okay? Over the product of simplexes is slightly different. So mild additional proof is needed to show that essentially GD fixed point over product of simplexes is equivalent to GD fixed point over a cube. Okay, so, but this is not what I want to do in this talk. What I want to do in the remaining time that I have is to give you some taste of the main reduction, which is how we prove how we reduce the problem of five of GD fixed point to the problem of computing the Nash equilibrium in five polytensor identical interest games. Okay, so a first thing that I want to say is that in the paper of Fearnley, Goldberg, Hollender, and Savani, they show that in fact the problem, the two-dimensional variant of GD fixed point is essentially as power is computationally equivalent to the general problem. So we can restrict attention to smooth functions from the two-dimensional cube to the reals, okay? By the way, our reduction, before we knew the result, also applies in n dimensions, but the proof is easier in two dimensions. So I will present you the easier proof that uses the result. Before we knew this, we had a longer proof. So the initial attempt, maybe kind of the most naive one, is okay, you want to look at a two-player game, define the utility, think of two players. The first will choose the first real number, the second will choose the second real number, and set the action sets to be, for now, to be the entire interval 0, 1, and define the common utility to be just the potential. So the good properties of this game is that pure Nash equilibria are indeed local maxima. Right, because the player cannot, if player can deviate, if the gradient is positive, then he can deviate to a better point. But the first challenge that comes is that mixed Nash equilibria in this game need not correspond to any particular point even. I'm not talking even about the fact that it's not a local maxima, but essentially you have a distribution, or a product distribution over the cube, where some inequality holds, it does not correspond to any particular point. Okay, so the first modification that we can think of for this issue is to define a potential limitation game. So this is this idea has appeared in a recent paper by Aviad and myself, where we defined the following game. Think of now, instead of having choosing only a point X, let's think of choosing two points, X and Y. Okay, so instead of two players, now we have four of them. And what the players are trying to do, essentially, they try to imitate each other. And but also they have some mild incentive. In fact, one of them, the X player, has a mild incentive to choose points with high potential, which is this part. The good properties of this game is that for mixed strategies, even right, the main challenge and the main issue of this paper is how to deal with mixed strategies. This is essentially the main challenge, and the nice property is that for mixed strategies, the best replies of X1 are concentrated around the expectation of Y1, because simply because expectation minimizes square error, and Y epsilon around because we have this epsilon term which can slightly ruin what we need. So essentially, we can deduce from it that X and Y are supported on the same epsilon ball. And there, if the gradient is positive in this epsilon ball, then this point does not correspond to, is not an equilibrium. Why? Because let's think of X deviating toward the gradient in the direction of the gradient. So he will have quadratic imitation loss, right? Here he will lose quadratic term, while his gain in the potential will be linear. So for sufficiently small deviation, he will gain from such a deviation. Okay, so this is the idea of quadratic versus linear, which makes this game to be a good starting point. Okay. But obviously we do not want in our game players have a continuum of action. In fact, we also do not want them to have exponential number of actions, but we want polynomial number of actions. So instead of having one player who chooses a point in 0, 1, well, let's do the most maybe naive thing. Let's replace him, or I don't know if most naive, but let's think of n players with action 0, 1 who chooses the binary representation of the point xi. Okay, we replace a single player by many players who just choosing bits. What the problem now? The problem now is that moving from 0, let's say from 0, 1, 1, 1 to 1, 0, 0 requires collective deviation of all players, right? We need all of them to switch their actions. And recall that in our construction, we want, in fact, players to make tiny deviations, because we do not remember the quadratic quadratic loss versus the linear gain in the potential. It's crucial there that the deviation will be tiny. Otherwise, it will not work. And the modification that we insert to this game is that each group, we include a veto player who can enforce a suffix of the binary string to be 0111 or 100. For example, if this is the currently played beat, and the veto player decides to veto all players after player four and on, then the tail of this sequence, the suffix, will be 1000, irrespective of what the beat players have to. Okay. Now, if we want to deviate from here to, from 0111 to 100, it's simple. The player who will do this deviation is the veto player. He will impose a veto on the first bit, and he will switch, change the number from 0111 to 100. Okay. The next challenge that we have is that the utilities should be explicitly.
So what anybody can be a veto, or a veto is fixed. So you have two n possible deviations.
Possible actions for the veto player. Veto is a different player who has two n plus one actions. One of them do nothing. I'm happy with what my players are doing. Another one is to choose a point from which he imposes a veto.
Okay, so that's 2n, right? Oh, you say plus 1, which means do nothing. But there are 2n deviations. Doing nothing means, yeah. So the number of deviations is 2n, rather than 2 to the power n. That's the point.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So the utility should be explicitly given. Right, we cannot include the term, so in particular the term phi of x in the utility is illegal. So here we use similar technique to what has been done in previous literature and PPAD on this context. We place a player in each gate of the circuit who is incentivized to apply correct computation on his gates. It's slightly different from the existing literature because we need to build the incentives via identical interest local games, right? Where there, the issue of identical interest, it did not appear, but essentially it can be modified to work also here.
So Yakov, can you explain how it, I don't understand, how does it help you that you place a player in each gate?
So the idea is that essentially, who will compute instead of a circuit that computes something, we will have inputs to, that will be given by these bit players, and then we will have separate players who will make computations on this bit, and they will be incentivized to do it correctly, and then in the output you will have actual players who are playing the bits of the output, and these players will essentially, and this we will refer to it in the game as if it was the correct the term phi of x. In practice, it's in fact just actions that are chosen by players, but if we do it correctly and incentivize them correctly, then in fact the computations will be correct, and the output indeed will, in equilibrium, will be phi of x. Okay.
Okay.
the next challenge that we have is, remember that we had the game was essentially some imitate quadratic loss plus epsilon times the potential. And in this game, the reward from deviating to a higher potential, let's say from a point X to X prime, was immediate, right? I just deviate and automatically I get higher payoff. Now, phi, as I just explained, is computed by the circuit players. And a change from X to X prime only causes wrong computation without any reward. Right? Instead of when I'm deviating there, right, we are talking about unilateral deviation. So if the X player, the veto player, or let's say some bit player switches his action, then I'm just, the only effect that it has is only that it has wrong computations. No reward, because the circuit, the utility of the circuit remains to be the same in a unilateral deviation. So the modification that we have here, we add another term where essentially here I think it should be gradient of X, not not of XY. Okay, so what I we give some mild incentive to the Y player to deviate in the direction of the gradient, right? We simply multiply his number by the gradient of it. And now the reward from Y, right, when the gradient is positive, Y want to be as close as possible to one, right? He want to increase the number. And when the gradient is negative, he want to decrease this number to be as close to zero as possible, okay? And now the reward from toward the gradient is immediate. Now the Y player actually gets a reward from deviation. Finally, and this is the final challenge, when X switches from X to X prime, it causes wrong computation, circuit computation. This force is more significant than trying to imitate Y, right? Why is it so? Essentially, because of the quadratic gain loss in the imitation versus linear losses in the computation, but this time it works not in favor of us, but against us. So players will not really want to deviate to a different input because the computation will be wrong. So how to incentivize the X player to move to X? And this is in fact the main challenge where we need quite a few changes to what I just said. I do not have a lot of time, so let me tell you just briefly what we do. So first issue is that helps us to overcome this problem is that think so far we thought of X as the input to the circuit, but let's say that only a small number of bits of X enter to the circuit and the other are just real numbers. So the precision of X and the precision of Y is much, let's think of them as much higher than the precision of the circuit. Another issue, a combination essentially of these modifications is the idea of sampling. Let me tell you briefly what is the idea of sampling. It's not new, it appeared in the PPAD literature, where essentially close to the boundary points, the boundaries where the circuit input changes, you may have problems. But what you do is essentially you create many copies of similar players who face similar problems, but with some shifts, with some constant shifts. And then if one group is located on the boundary, you are ensured that the others are far and they behave well. So this is something that, we modify this idea to slightly different setting of PPAD intersection PLS, or let's say to a CLS setting, which is needed to be done slightly differently. And finally, this is in the spirit of Krempel, which is a paper on CLS. We add a guide player who essentially among all these similar groups who face a similar idea, he's incentivized to choose one that behaves well. namely has a high low imitation loss, computes a high potential, and makes correct computations. So essentially, and the combination of these three issues essentially allows us to overcome this issue that when someone gets close to the boundary, then he's simply not chosen by the guide player, and this fact allows the X player indeed to move to a different point because the computation there is negligible, while the imitation remains to be important. Okay, so I do not have time. Let me sum up with finish the talk with some open problems. So for the open problems, we can just look at the picture of diagram how this class looks like. So we still see that there are interesting problems that are that we do not know to say about them. So for one of them is, are network congestion games complete for PPAD intersection PLS? I'm strongly conjecture that it is true, but we are only epsilon close to prove it. And epsilon sometimes might be very far from actual proof. Are identical interest polymatrix games complete for PPAD intersection PLS? We know it only for polytensor games, but it would be very, very nice to see it for polymatrix games. And finally, another one which has, I think, nice consequence in optimization. Our reduction does not hold for binary action games. In fact, we need polynomial number of actions for the players. And the question whether we can do such a reduction with binary actions. And the reason, if it's true, we'll have the following corollary, that local optimization of constant degree multilinear polynomials is computationally equivalent to local optimization of binary arbitral smooth functions. So far, we have the multilinear property only for domains which are product of simplexes. For the cube, we do not know it. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Yakov. So we're out of time, so whoever needs to leave is welcome to do so. And if there are any questions,